Okay, I'm gonna call the meeting of the Planning and Zoning Commission to order, please.
I got a call from Alan, he's not coming.
Okay, very good. In the absence of Al, what is today? Today is 4/16. So we need to appoint two voting alternates, and we're gonna appoint Michael Flynn and Kathy Shire as the voting alternates. Very good, okay, they're appointed. So everyone who's sitting at the table is voting. All right, can approval of the agenda, please? Any changes, alterations, amendments, deletions?
What addition, I have an update from Justin on behalf of the workers collective in Salisbury housing. Can I just read that out at the right time?
Sure, we can put that under... So what is it? It's Justin's, the collaborative?
The collaborative and the housing commission in...
Collaborative and housing commission, okay, we'll put that as housing. We'll put that as number 11, under new business, under Kathy Shire reporting on that.
Thank you.
Any other additions? Okay, I entertain a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
And a second, please?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Let's go to the minutes, please. The first meeting is of March 25th, 2013. I was not there, so I am not going to really participate or vote on this. So those who were there.
I've got on page 1, line 28. Instead of requirement, I would say limit.
I'm sorry, say that.
Instead of requirement, limit.
Pervious surface limit?
Okay. Right.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, makes sense. It's a limit.
We don't want to require
it. Could you turn your button on?
Oh.
Sure. That helps, thanks.
Okay. And on page 2, line 21, instead of deliverables, I'd call them revisions the commission had decided to postpone. And that's what do you think of that, Mike? This is part that you were...
I'm trying to find it, because unfortunately the copy I got.
Oh.
No line numbers.
Here, I got it red, is what it was.
That's okay, next to the last paragraph.
Four lines.
In the absence of deliverables.
He's suggesting.
I think the lack of monthly in. I think you know. I don't really think we need to put that in there.
Just take it out. The lack of.
Well, I would say the lack of monthly invoices would have the. Monthly invoices would have provided the commission. I don't understand that. I mean, it's well understood that we asked Tom to do things over and above the contract and
right.
The sign regulations.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the point. I mean, the sign regulations are referenced, and I thought...
Where are they referenced?
After that, in parentheses.
Right? Yeah, well, what do you think about just removing...
I'm sure it's removed.
I think remove it because, yeah. You know, there was just say... lack of monthly invoices would have provided the commission opportunity for some oversight of the process, which was problematic.
Well, if you take sign regulations out, there was an absence of deliverables too.
Well, what
was take right? Sign regulations out of the sentence, and then the sentence makes sense.
But was there an absence of deliverables, Mike?
Well, yeah, there were certain regulations that never came to a final. Draft to go into the new regulations. Signs was one of them.
Yeah, but it was still things that...
Cluster housing was another one.
But it wasn't because Tom didn't deliver them.
That's right.
We decided that we weren't going to catch them any further.
The sign regulations were delivered multiple... Well, yeah, whatever. I mean,
everyone, it's...
All right.
Have you reached a consensus on what we're doing with this place?
Well, I think the fact that we say that there's a continuation of the discussion, maybe does that kind of cover your concerns, Mike, that we did discuss this and there was a difference of opinion. Otherwise, we're saying that we all agreed that the deliverables were absent.
I think there are two separate points. One is the frequency of invoicing, and the other one is that there was work that was delivered by Tom, but we didn't take it all the way. It was extra work. I'm happy to leave it in the way Fred wrote it. I don't think it makes any sense to call it just deliverables. I think it might as well stay in there.
What should stay in, Kathy?
Fred's rewritten.
I don't know what that is.
So that it says, in absence of revisions, the Commission has decided to postpone sign regulations and parentheses in the lack of monthly invoices, which will be provided the Commission.
Oh, no, but you
can't.
I object to that strongly. I mean, the entire thing was that there were things that we asked him over and above the contract, including redoing sign regulations
and research.
But not limited to, and so I think you're mixing apples and oranges here. I think there is one point is if we had all seen monthly invoices, it would have helped us manage the process.
We all had a consensus on that.
But I'm not sure what I did not see any deliverables that were not delivered. So
right, that's
I think there was a lot. There were yeah. Well, okay. That would take the whole thing out.
Okay. I agree with that.
Because, you know, we asked him, the part of the problem is we asked him for extra things that, you know.
Yeah, revisions the Commission decided to postpone.
So you want to call revisions the absence
of revisions? So why don't we just...
But the absence of the revisions that the Commission decided to postpone have nothing to do with the contract.
The contract was for the entire set of regulations, which would have included all of those. And the contract also had specific delivery times with certain windows prior to the Commission actually meeting. I mean, a lot of these things didn't happen. And yeah, it all comes back to the fact of oversight by the Commission itself. I mean, I don't know how you word that, because that was the sense I had, was that the Commission, by not following its own rules and its contracts that it made, was more or less a failure. And I know we disagreed on that, but you know, that's however you write it, it's not really been expressed fully. There was a discussion over it, it was agreed that there were mistakes made in the process, and the process needs to be reviewed.
Yeah, well, without getting into a big discussion, but I think the sentence before that, doesn't that reflect what you were, because we should reflect that you were bringing up some points about it. And I think the sentence before that kind of does that, so.
This can be simplified by taking out the first clause and just focusing on the monthly invoices. Because as things transpire, this is reflecting ongoing conversation and ongoing comments.
Yeah.
But things did transpire, things were reconciled. So we could just take out the clause of absence of deliverables, sign regulations, and say the lack of monthly invoices would have provided the Commission an opportunity for some, or monthly invoices
yes.
would have provided the Commission
an opportunity.
That's fine.
Because oversight
good.
Was
right.
the process, which was problematic.
Good.
That would
yes.
be okay?
Right.
Yeah.
Yes? Okay. Because it did continue to be discussed. It was, you know, it went on, it was ongoing. Okay.
Any other corrections, Marty?
No, I don't have any with it.
Kathy, Mike?
No.
Fred?
No.
Entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second, please.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And I abstain, please.
Yep, I got it. Okay.
Let's move to the minutes of the April 2.
Or second.
Yes, April 2.
I thought you said April 2.
April
sorry.
2.
April 2.
2 April 2013. Okay. And I'll start at the end there with Marty. Do you have any comments on this one, Marty?
I do not.
Okay, Fred.
Let's see, page 2. Starting with 13. I'd like to take out the sentence, it may be that the pre-existing use of the property was lost with the foreclosure. Perhaps the question should be presented to the P&Z attorney for clarification. I don't think that was an issue, because the legally non-conforming status of the land stays with the land.
Well, that was definitely part of the conversation. It was one of the points that Peter Oliver made. And by listing these in bullet points, they're saying these were the things that were discussed, and that was definitely part of the conversation.
Yeah, he brought it up.
It's not saying that it is, it's not saying that it's not, but it was certainly discussed, and I think it should be there.
Okay.
Well, then I think she attributed it to Peter Oliver. That's what I asked it. And I think both the last bullets need to be attributed, because the first one is a matter of fact. Mm-hmm. That is a factual item. And the last two were representations made by Peter Oliver. And I had the same question. I had that bracketed, the one that Fred had, that sentence. It may be, but if that was the pre-existing status, I was going to take it out. But that's your recollection of what he said. We definitely have to attribute it. Both those statements to Peter Oliver.
Yeah, as long as they're attributed to Peter, that's kind of
But Peter didn't say perhaps his question should be presented to the P&Z attorney for clarification.
That's correct.
You can't attribute that to Peter.
No, I said that.
Right.
I thought there was consideration of seeking a legal opinion on the question of whether the pre-existing use had been abandoned.
Okay, that works.
Did that work?
Yes.
Say it again, Fred.
There was consideration of seeking a legal opinion on the question of whether the pre-existing use had been abandoned.
Okay.
And on page 3, line 3.
Do you want me to, wait a second, do you want me to take out the question then, that perhaps this should be presented, put this in instead?
Fred, he just gave you the language.
Yes, I know he did. You want me to take out the, perhaps this question should be presented and put into sentence instead?
You want to just, I've got it right here.
Yeah, no, okay. All right, got it.
Gee, he's handing other sheets, huh?
Yeah, right.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm just so many people want to grab it from me, that's all. page 3, line 3. Tom McGowan has also removed payment requests. Mm. Insert the word payment.
Page 3, line 3. Payment requests?
Insert the word payment after removed.
Okay.
Remove payment requests.
Yep, okay.
And line 5. Change but to and.
You're on different numbers.
Oh, okay. I downloaded this one.
Yes, yeah, so what?
That's
what. There was a heated discussion about the budgeting cost and the actual cost. Poland report.
Oh, here it is.
Line 3.
Yeah, line 3. Change the but.
You need to read the sentence.
Yeah, it's line 3. After Poland report, change but to and.
Yeah. We've all remembered the provisions, regulations, and recommended and that we can incorporate the proposed regulations as they are now presented. Okay, does anyone object to that?
No.
Okay,
that's all for me.
Okay, Kathy?
A little confusion on page 3, line 16, where it says, allowed in the zone when zoning was originally adopted were no longer allowed uses.
Where is this?
Line 16.
On what page?
3.
3, excuse me.
It was felt that most of the uses that were allowed in the zone when zoning was originally adopted were no longer allowed uses. This was the light industrial zone.
I understand, but shouldn't it say when zoning was originally adopted, are no longer being employed or...
The bottom line is I think it needs some richness there. It's actually the actually prohibited by the aquifer overlay. Mm-hmm. That's what it really is. What's interfering with many of the industrial uses is the aquifer or the wellhead overlay in that zone.
Right.
And that is why even if you have the right to do it, you can't have many of these light industrial uses anymore. So as I said, it's an anachronism to have that zone for light industrial.
Okay, so yeah. Needs different wording.
Well, that's, you know, she's just saying that many of the things that are going on there by virtue of the zone itself, forget about the aquifer, are prohibited just by virtue of the zone.
No, they're not prohibited
There's residential dwelling down there that's not permitted by the zone. I mean, the zone doesn't permit a lot of things. So it's a factual statement. It actually should say it was spelled. It was a fact that many of the uses now going on down there aren't allowed because there's nothing industrial there.
That's the exact opposite.
Yeah, there are several different points.
By the creation of the lake, of the aquifer zones, or however you want to say right. it, some uses are now prohibited.
That were formerly allowed.
Correct. That's what you want to say.
But then,
and that's somewhere around there.
But Mike raises another point, which is really, again, the other point is that in fact, de facto, there are already things going on in that zone that aren't part of the zone. So there are really two thoughts. One thing is you can't be industrial because of the aquifer. Mike says that actually there are things going on in there now that are not part of the zone. So I mean, there really, again, there are two. I think it sounds by trying to cobble everything into one sentence, I think one loses nuance. If we need to be that precise about it, I think it requires two sentences.
Yeah.
Because they're two different thoughts.
That's right.
Okay. Let's rewrite the sentences.
You want me to fix it?
I think we're running into a situation where minutes are getting again a little bit too verbatim.
Do you want to just lift that sentence out and go to CG20 and Planemans will contact him again and the rest of Breton Draft? Because you are continuing with the discussion about the LI20 zone.
Yes.
Go on and request a written
draft of
your proposed change to have available for
review for 6. Well, maybe it could just change to are no longer suitable because of the aquifer and water. What was your language, Nancy?
Aquifer protection.
Right. And that's maybe all you need to say there, and it fixes that.
No longer suitable.
Yes.
That's a good word.
But if you say that, I do think you have to say what Mike's brought up too, which is equally important, is that many of the activities going on in that zone, actually, there are things that are not, I would just assume, I think less is more here. And I don't think we need all this detail, but that's,
All right.
Yeah.
Would you like to table it and I'll...
No, we're not tabling, I think you just heard, I think Mike just said take it up.
Well, as Garrett suggests, I think it's best, it's all obvious. There are two things in play there.
Right, exactly.
And anyone can go to records and look at what the LI zone prohibits, and they can look at what the aquifer prohibits, and
come up with a couple of things. And then we'll see what people said. So that creates the pressure I'm trying to carry on.
Well, I think what we're left with expresses what happened to the public, and they can understand
exactly
where we're going, and if they want the more information, they can come to public hearing.
That's right.
Hopefully we will.
Mike?
I have nothing.
Okay.
More.
All right. Okay. Well, we did get this thing resolved on the Peter Oliver. So we have two of the statements attributed to Peter. I have a recollection, and maybe it's not important, that John Higgins also indicated that it was very difficult on the Brennan Thomas proposal, that there was absolutely no specificity. And he said, you know, there's nothing there. But whether or not that's, there's, you know, he made some comment that we really can't say much because you really don't know.
Because you don't know what they're doing.
They were really, it was very vague compared to the other one. But we don't have to put that in, I just bring that up. Is Freddie Mac, isn't that F-R-E-D-D-I-E? Not Y, just I'm not sure.
Well, I think it may be.
Yeah, I think it is because Fanny is F-A-N-N-I-E, so Freddie is I-E.
Okay.
My great. On line number 32, it is the Lakeville Villards Center, not Cantor. All right, now on page number 3, line 6, I would just like to say discussion. Actually, there's no need to say it was a heated discussion. I think we have a lot of discussions that are heated. This has been no heated in other ones, and I think it we don't need to editorialize.
Okay.
Yeah.
So a little warm, or you call it heated.
It's just passionate. Why don't you say a passionate discussion?
It is Freddie, i.e.
I am right on Freddie, thank you.
Yes, you are right on that.
I deleted heated.
Yes, and I'm fine with the other thing. There was disagreement as to what the cost. I'm fine with that, and so that's are my comments on that. All right. Anybody else? Last chance. We're going on. Entertain a motion for approval. Please.
Move to accept the April 2nd minutes as amended.
Aye. Fred. All those in favor?
Aye.
No abstentions. No. All right, now we go to number 5. We have our moment of public comment. Restricted items that are neither on the agenda or the subject of any planning commission pending action. Hearing none, we're going to move on to old business. The LI-20 zone change to CG-20 zone discussion of amendment. Now, it's not really an amendment. What Tom has prepared is prepared the notice because we don't really have, it's not an amendment in the sense that generally prepares an ordinance. Once we just remove the zone. So he put the legal call there and for the public hearing. And that's basically will end up being, if we approve it, will end up being what the legal notice will be. And then we will work with Garrett to get it all out of the out of the regs, but it will happen after, it will not happen, the regs, it will be in the regs that are going to public hearing. We're not going to, because that's up on the website, we're not touching that. But once that is, then it will be removed from the regs. But we need a public hearing. And any other comments? Do you remember the public here to talk about this? There was going to be a public hearing too. All right. Does this appear in order to everyone to go forward with this? Everyone happy with that? Then have we actually set the public hearing? Or
yes, we did.
We did. So we're all happy with that, and we'll go forward with that. There was an article in the Lakeville Journal, so we did get out.
Yeah,
it was
good.
Yep, I think we did. So the word is out. It does not seem to be a very controversial thing. I haven't heard anything pro or con.
When is the public hearing?
May 8th.
Yeah, and bear in mind, everyone is aware that we are meeting on Wednesday the 8th, because on the 7th there is a meeting that was in our schedule. We have the school vote on the 7th, so it'll be May 8th. It will not only be that public hearing, but it'll be the public hearing for the regulations. So it'll be a big night for public hearings. Okay, let's move on to item number 7, to accept and set a public hearing for the property at 511 Lime Rock Road. It's a Burgell property, re-subdivision of 37 acres into 2 lots. And I understand the attorney has agreed.
Correct.
That we can have that public hearing on 521, because we don't want to be...
Three public hearings.
Public hearings at once. We figured spread it out. And there was an agreement. Anyone have any comments on that? an attorney here for that?
No.
All right. I guess we need a motion to set that public hearing, please. Don't all rush.
I'll make a motion to set the public hearing for the 511 Lime Rock Road subdivision for May 21st at 6:45 p.m.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Oh, wow. Very good. That was under the wire first. All those in favor?
Aye.
Marty was louder.
I think Marty just beat my question like that. Okay. Great. All right. Now we have number 8. We have a site plan amendment for 105 U.S. Route 7, Salisbury. That is the Lime Rock Auto. Is that, in fact, the correct zip code for the Lime Rock Auto?
Oh, yeah. 0608?
Really?
Mm-hmm. No.
No. No. I think it's 0603.
Oh, good. 0603.
Thank you.
0603.
My error. I'm sorry.
0639. You know, I'm just going to clarify.
You just want to.
Okay. 06039. Okay. All right.
And we have this gentleman here to represent the application.
Okay.
Good evening. For the record, my name is Ryan Cameron. I'm project manager with CCA out of our Litchfield office. What we're requesting tonight is a site plan modification of a plan previously designed and approved by Allied Engineering Associates, George Johannesson, engineer. And in that original design, he had a building here of 2,664 feet, the auto repair shop. And his plan was to put a apartment above that shop. Our client has requested that the apartment now be over the convenience store rather than over the garage, and that this building be extended by 4 feet.
So forward toward where?
Toward the road.
Toward the road.
What is the reason for that?
To provide more room for the working area inside the garage.
So you're increasing the size of the room.
This is that green area is, you know, 4 feet, 4 additional feet. On the building, and then take the apartment from above that building and put it above this building. It's more appropriate for the residential apartment.
To be over a
convenience store. Convenience store rather than a garage.
Sure, sure. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's the extent of the request for the modification. Very, very.
Will this change the elevations? I mean, Carmen, there was a lot of discussion about how this thing was going to look, even though it was questionable how much. I know there was a lot of discussion at the time. Is it still going to look the same?
It's going to be the same. It's just going to be on this building rather than on that building.
And do you have
We don't have any elevations, no.
But that building is going to stay the same size with the exception of the 4 feet in the front.
That's correct.
I mean, as far as I see what you're saying, the 4 feet in front of the
building. It's only going to be one story rather than two stories.
Right, so it's actually, it's changed.
Right.
And that's going to become a two-story building.
And this is going to become a two-story building.
Right.
They were both approved as two-story buildings.
They were.
Are they both approved?
Correct. Yeah, the only thing we're trying to apologize. I'm the advocate. I'm Jonathan McCassian from Lime Rock Auto. I've seen some of this before.
They approved two stories on both?
Yes.
Correct. Yeah, originally they approved the living quarters above the shop and storage above the store.
That's right.
So they simply want to swap that.
So my question is, are they going to still look balanced like they were? Because I know that was one of the things. They were equal. Are they both going to be the elevation to look the same then?
Yes. Well, you mean the height of the building?
Correct.
Shouldn't be changing.
Are you putting storage over the auto shop?
Correct.
Oh, okay.
I apologize. That was my mistake.
Okay, that is because there was a lot of
there was a lot of back.
I've lived this for a number of years.
Okay, so basically what you're doing is you're flipping the storage with the residence and pushing out the base 4 feet.
Correct. Yeah, basically the current shop building.
That got there some air issues going on.
Okay. Do we have the wither around?
No, sir. The traffic pad, the original traffic pad, it hasn't changed, am I right?
That's correct.
There's nothing.
Was there some, the Appalachian Trail was involved in this thing somewhere where
Yes.
you had to get their permission from the United correct. States government to do whatever you had to do?
Sightlines, correct.
Is that still in?
Yes, it is.
That's all?
Correct. Yeah, nothing else has changed.
And they wanted to cut some trees for the sightline, wasn't that what
correct,
it was?
Yeah. The ability to manage the shrubs going around the corner. Right.
Do we have that on record? Were they allowed you to do that? Because they're
as far as I know, correct.
Yeah, from the state?
It was a chief ranger.
No, from the Appalachian Trail, from the United States government.
Yes.
Yep.
It's all George Johansson.
Was it a condition of approval anyway?
Yeah, it was.
Yes,
yeah.
It was.
Yeah. I just wondered if one of you still had
it. It was a condition of approval for DOT sightline.
Right.
Yeah.
They wouldn't have referenced.
Right.
First,
correct.
You had to go to the
yeah, they wouldn't have approved the curb cuts for the driveways yeah. without the
right.
Correct.
It's all coming back.
All coming back, right. Oh, yes. Flooding, a little thing across. Yeah. There's a lot on here.
Yeah.
So, I guess what is required of us administratively? Do we need to set up a public hearing? Because
it's just an amendment to the approved special permit and site plan. Changing.
Do we have the discretion to set a public hearing?
Yes.
I just want to know. I mean, I'm not saying we should do it. I'm just asking the unpopular question. If I members see. Of the commission thought that it should be looked at again by the public, we could.
I suppose.
But, as I understand, representative, there's not going to be a substantive exterior change.
It's no.
I was going to say, if you're going to have a building with one tall and one short, you might have had some people not happy.
Yeah, no, we were originally approved with
right, well, you're keeping your building. That's what right. I want to understand.
Yep.
Does any member of the commission feel we need to have a public hearing on this?
No.
I don't think so.
Okay. No, that I don't think so either.
I don't think it was controversial at the time.
There was some. There was something.
It yeah. was controversial amongst the commission.
Unless the commission doesn't put it on the
phone. We're at a different era now. We're controversies.
Knock on wood.
Okay, you don't think there's any public interest served by doing that? That's what I'm trying to do. I don't care about whether we can have heated disagreements or what. As long as the public interest is served. Okay, can we make that amendment this evening?
Mm-hmm.
And there's nothing else that's triggered by moving that out. It's within setbacks and all of
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely, I've checked
that out.
Yeah, I've checked the bar. Yeah.
All right. So, and when we, if and when we approve this, does that start a whole new clock running, or is it still within the same timeline clock?
It will start a whole new 5-year
clock. Okay. All right.
We'll talk about it.
Well, unfortunately, it does.
No, just
it gives you more time.
Yes, it does. This one, I'm able to know that. So.
I need investors, not time.
All right. Do I have a motion to accept this site plan amendment?
So,
as meeting our requirements.
Oh, Mike just moved.
You did? Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, you want to use my language. I'm not supposed to make the motion, but okay. So you
just have the language for the motion?
I just said, just being the requirement.
I said so moved. You read the language, so moved covers it.
Okay.
Meeting site plan requirements.
Site plan requirements, yeah. Site plan requirements.
It's approved,
definitely. And also that we had to, and please make the minutes reflect that we did have a discussion about whether we needed a public hearing, that there was not a sense that the public interest that was would be enhanced by doing such.
Okay.
All right, we have a motion from Mike. We need a second.
I'll second.
Kathy, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? Very good. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well,
you did it, would you? Yeah.
So I heard that.
Very good.
Thank you.
Next, Mary Silks is
up. Mr. Joe received the... We all received...
No, here we go.
She's an incompetent chair of the lake. Okay, Mary, okay, can I have us all focused? Because I'm tired. I don't want this to run into this meeting. I'm going to call you. Mary put together an added discussion with Mary, and I didn't know what was going to come up being actual revisions to the language of the POCD. I thought we were going to be giving us suggestions for regulations. But you're on the agenda. This is your floor. Explain what you'd like us to do.
And why?
Why? Yeah.
Thank you for putting me on the agenda. You know, I understand that you don't, you know, the last thing you want to do is revisit the POCD after doing all that hard work on it the first time. But my concern is road runoff into Lakeville Lake, especially on Millerton Road. So the Lake Onondaga Potomac Association has really been working hard the last few years. We're trying to expand our membership, increase awareness of lakeshore and watershed issues with property owners. We are working on new educational materials for property owners. We're in the fourth year of our Lake Keeper program, which collects lake data and analyzes lake data. So we have some, you know, we started with a baseline, so we have, you know, the parameters that can be analyzed. We have sponsored programs that are open to the public on lake landscaping, low impact development, rain gardens, buffers, native plants. But the one thing that kind of eludes us is the issue of stormwater runoff. It's kind of beyond the scope of what we can do. So a grant, if we could get a grant money to do a study on the runoff from roads, that would be a good thing. But it's really hard to get a grant these days. And anything that we can do to create an application that would be more competitive for grant money would increase the chances that we could get funding. There is a Connecticut Lake Grants Program, which was funded years ago with $687,000, but it was frozen and the money hasn't been released. So the chances of it being released are kind of slim, but they're there. Apparently, every month, the DEEP requests that the funds be released. And the Connecticut Federation of Lakes Organization also requests that, to make grants available for towns, but the chances are slim. I did talk to Chuck Lee yesterday from DEP, and he said that we might have a better chance with the STEEP program, the Small Towns Economic Assistance, which did fund a project about 20 years ago on the Sucker Brook with, you know, sort of the same issue. These two grant programs, and then we're looking into private grant programs too, and other grants that might be available. But these two programs, the Lake Association cannot apply for it. It has to be a town applying. But the Lake Association can help, you know, with that. And we have someone who is willing to work on that project. But the planning and zoning can help too, because if the wording was changed in the plan of conservation and development just slightly, and emphasizing, and those are that's the reason that I have a list of changes. It could be lakes. If lakes were listed as a priority in the town plan, then they would have a better chance of being listed on the state plan as a conservation priority. So if we could get a conservation designation on the state plan, that would really it greatly enhance the chances that our lake could get a grant for the stormwater runoff issue. So that's why I'm asking you to consider making a few changes to just at least list lakes, name lakes as something, as a resource that should be protected.
And you don't find that in the plan of conservation and development?
No, because on page 48, where there's a list of things we want to protect, the lakes are omitted because it says minimize stressors that degrade rivers, streams, and wetlands, but lakes aren't in there. Actually, there isn't. Lakes aren't in there. So if lakes could be listed in this plan as something that the town wanted to protect, the state would be more, you know, we might have a better chance of getting a grant for runoff. And runoff is not,
let me say something about this, because we had a public hearing.
I said exactly the same thing at the public hearing.
And these didn't get in?
No.
And I mean, everything in the public hearing was discussed by the commission, and we put a lot more stuff about the lakes in responding to. To realize that we meant it, we have to go to a public hearing. To realize that we have, I think, how many copies printed?
250.
We printed hard copies, and there's a whole process. And is there a way to accomplish your goals if you want to get, you know, grant to get letters or other things?
What if we were to just issue a resolution, statement of principle, and add that to, well, I just present that as reflecting the town's desire to keep the lakes.
I have to read the whole POCD because I can't believe that one can't go through the POCD and see a commitment to the lakes. I think there was also, in all honesty, a sense that we have a lot of other wetland resources too. We wanted to have some balance in the POCD.
That's true. You mentioned rivers, streams, and wetlands, but the word lakes is not in here. So.
Actually, for wetlands, it could be, or lakes are wetlands. I mean, the lakes are just, I mean, rivers are riparian. I mean, we could, it should have been, that would have been nice to have had it in there. I agree. We could have said lakes. I don't know why it didn't get in there. But
I honestly did say exactly the same thing before, not talking about the grant. The whole issue of perhaps having an edge on a grant by being classified as a resource, you know, it actually comes from an article that Tom McGowan wrote in the newsletter of Connecticut.
But I mean, what happens, Mary and John, is what happens is I love vernal pools and I love bog turtles. And all of a sudden, I want to get a grant and I want to amend the language to say we should protect our bog turtle resources. Now, Mike will go crazy about that. But, you know, or vernal pools. I mean, I just had, you know, I think you can accomplish your goals. I mean, I'm sorry that we didn't get certain language in there that would have maybe been more explicit. I don't quite understand how with all the public hearings and the revisions. But I personally am very supportive of what you're doing, but I just can't see us amending the POCD every time to make it work for a grant, because there are many other groups that will come for other reasons. There must be a way to accomplish this goal in a different way, short of having a public hearing, printing all the POCDs that we had. We did print 250 hard copies that would all be null and void or not valid. I mean, we'd have to put errata sheets into them. I mean, this is not a trivial thing.
It does say that it can be amended.
Yes.
If this is a working document and it's supposed to last for 10 years and things come up over the 10 years and you do in fact want to add or change something, do you have to reprint it?
Oh, absolutely. After we...
Just like you were doing the...
I understand the public hearing, I realize that, but you have to reprint that document to reflect every word change.
Absolutely.
It's part of the regulations.
All right.
I mean, generally, you know, we worked very hard to get it done, and I understand this all, I mean, I certainly think of it as a grant. One certainly can do a resolution, a spread, there are many ways that we could give support, and would gladly give support. But I just, you know, I'm in a very difficult position, because I understand what you're doing, and I support what you're doing. I just can't see us doing this at the POCD, particularly as it's so new.
If there's any other, you know, help, that any other ideas that you can give that might help with this issue, I know that this runoff issue has been around a long time, and there is one very large river of runoff that, you know,
I think you can accomplish your goals, frankly, without... Accomplish your goals without offering the POCD.
Without, okay.
That's my sense. I mean, I understand the state would like to see it. I think we could. There's many. I think we could. I think there are many ways we could support this, but I just can't see us doing this because of the costs, because of the precedent we'll set. Because then, you know, I was joking, but I could come in or someone. Because someone got to. They got to make the bog tour. Got to make various. We tried to create balance in the POCD. I'm sorry that the late, I mean, let me show you, that is too bad, because
I had my copy of the public hearing, and I said, why don't you have lakes listed as a natural resource?
Howard's book, Lakeshore Restoration.
Yeah, yes, Lakeshore Restoration. But to minimize stressors would have been, I think, the one that would have... Yeah, certainly.
No, but I mean, you know.
But if you can, if
lakes are included in wetlands, frankly, you have fringing. Mm-hmm. I mean, I could, and frankly, if you get to the grant zone and DEP, we could clarify that it was our intent that we considered lake. I think we could give that clarification.
Well, that's fine. That's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
fine.
Yeah. Yeah. Because I think since, I know Mary did come and speak about this at the time, but I think since then, you know, Mary, a couple of weeks ago, was given the impression that this money was going to be freed up, and now more discussion has led to you to believe that it's not going to be so easy. However, in all these people that you talk to, can you show them our POCD and see if it would work against us?
Well, I'm going to the meeting tomorrow night of the Connecticut Federation of Lakes. Chuck is leading the media. John Ballard, everybody will be here. I could ask them how. They all know about our runoff problem because it's been addressed to the state before. So
so the difference is the potential for this grant money being released. That's really what's the issue.
It really was Tom McGowan's article that kind of pushed me in this direction, that it's very competitive to get a grant. There's, you know, dozens of organizations looking for grant money. And if there's anything that you can do to give a little bit of edge to your application,
so this may not be perfect, so it may be perfectly good enough for the purpose of a grant application.
And maybe if the minutes tonight reflected that we clarified that wetlands includes lakes.
And we can give you a letter to that, the grant. I mean, right. I think, see what kind of, I think many people, I mean, I think these things are covered here. Rivers, streams, and wetlands, that's lakes. I mean, I'm just looking through it. I was just troubled. Encourage wetland riparian, riverside and lakeshore. I mean, the lakes are all in there. Encourage vegetated buffers, it's right there. Encourage wetland riparian restoration, it's right there, Jay. So I don't see why we need to add something.
I think though, in a lot of times, wetlands and lakes are separated. In most of the literature, is they are separate because they are slightly different. They have different, you know, ecology too.
Somewhat, I agree, but I think if you ask wetland professionals, they will consider lakes, particularly the lakes up here, because, you know, look at the lakes; they've got complex wetlands associated with them.
I think though that if this river of runoff was running into a wetland or a vernal pool, there would be a whole different...
I actually don't think so. I think this town does not have a very good record of protecting its wetlands, so I wouldn't think... I think your lakes are better, I think if we're running into the Housatonic River, you might. But I certainly think the lakes, unfortunately, fortunately for lake people, get a lot more protection, actually. Like, we have a general wetland issue in this town. We need to do a lot more for our wetlands than we do, including the lakes.
There is working on that, too.
Yeah.
I can assure you, it should be a wetlands if you've done it.
I would say one really fertile place of information to look at, go to the Connecticut Council of Environmental Quality, look at their things, and take a look if you're at the compliance, and I brought this up in the POCD, but take a look at how we rank in reporting and wetland protection against the other towns in the state.
Sounds good, no.
I'm not saying this, read it for yourself. So, I mean, I think, you know, we need help, we frankly need help for all wetlands in this town. And anything that would do to help begin to address stormwater runoff into a lake or a wetland is something I strongly support. I just don't support amending the POCD for the grant.
I obviously don't think this is the biggest issue for the town. I think affordable housing is the biggest issue for the town.
Without clean water and functional, healthy ecosystems, our entire human society will collapse. So I actually think it's probably one of the most defining and important issues of the day is keeping our environment and infrastructure healthy. Maybe more important than some of the other issues. Because if there's no clean water and nowhere healthy to live, what's the point? That's my very broad environment.
Mary, when you're talking about stormwater runoff, are you talking about off of private property? Because the state's just as guilty as it is. The state is more, you know, all our catch basins.
I'm talking about the state, yeah, because... Yeah.
You're talking about the DOT line.
I am.
Yes,
The private property runoff, we're trying to address through education, through that, because that really has to be the property owner that... I see it changing too. I see people's attitudes changing. I see the application last week, the wetlands application. They had a rain garden.
Right.
So I do see it changing. But the DOT issue on 44 is deplorable. Yeah,
doesn't that kind of reflect the old way of looking at handling stormwater? You get rid of it. if there's a wetland, that's where it goes. Fast as possible.
Yes.
Well, it also reflects, unfortunately, the way the DOT, the culture in the DOT, which is very slow to change, is that they feel they have the right to discharge onto private property. And Curtis and I have talked about this. I mean, these are huge issues. It's further down on Main Street. There is just, they have the right to discharge over your property. And what's interesting, and we had some issues, is once the dirty water gets onto property X, it becomes your dirty water, and then you are in trouble for discharging it. There's a real problem, and I think the DOT needs to think about how to deal with runoff better. But it's interestingly enough, the only wetland permit that has been reported by this town in 20 years to the state on action is a single one for the DOT. That's the only wetland permit action that the state has in this town for 20-some years of any wetland decision.
When was it? How long ago was it?
It's just showing that the DOT did file a report. It was about 20 years ago of the DOT. But it's interesting. We have no idea exactly what's going on. There's no tracking at all because our town does not report, as required by law, the decisions of its Wetlands Commission of the state, and has not done. And it is chronically not doing it. Peter's going to go off the deep end when he hears that, but still it hasn't changed. We do not report, we're required by law to report our wetlands. All our wetland decisions should be reported to the state database. So the state has no idea, and I think that, frankly, will hurt any grant application more than this, because we are viewed as a town that is really not complying with state statute as far as wetlands reporting. So that's, in my advice to him, a much bigger issue for us to get under control in this town. We have the dubious distinction, I think we're lumped with Bridgeport, Waterbury, and a few other large urban areas as being chronic non-reporters of wetland decisions.
Well, I know that I live in Woodbury, and a friend of mine is the chairman of the Wetlands Commission in Woodbury, and they are extremely diligent. She's now...
Oh, then many that are very diligent.
And, so I guess we are kind of... We have a few hurdles to overcome.
I think the first one, though, in your mind, Mary, if you can show that document and get confident that that does, you know, really reflect the importance of lakes to this town. I think it does it in many ways. It also does it very much pictorially. I think that it will create quite an impact, and perhaps within an ideal world, you could add the odd word in, as you have proposed. But I think it would be interesting to hear back from people that you would show that to, would say it's fine.
If they say it's an impact, I mean, say that you also were in a font, that we would be very, you can get a very, very strong, affirmative letter from this commission. If there is that we can, if they can't see that POCD and connect the dots, we certainly can connect the dots in a letter that goes along with
the grant.
Does the DOT have updated standards that will not permit what they're doing, what has been done, and the current situation to occur?
There's a lot of talk about stormwater runoff, but is that just talk?
My point is that if they've updated their standards to reflect the newer way of looking at this.
I will ask if anyone tomorrow night at that meeting knows if the DOT standards are.
That way you use their own standards to make them
I don't even think they came and fixed that problem. I think Curtis had to get the town crew out there to fix the problem on a state road.
Well,
They were working on private property at the edge of the lake. The problem came across from Belgo Road and down on 41, and there'd been so much time wasted, it was really a problem. I think Curtis just had to step in and do it with the town crew. He was not working on a state road.
So
he was working on where
Coming off of Belgo?
Yeah.
It's coming both
places. Well, part of that is the storm drains are all clogged up. When it rains, I live right there. It shoots up out of them 5-6 feet in the air because it can't go anywhere.
It does, but there's an 18-inch pipe. It's not nearly.
Yeah, but when it's all clogged up and it hasn't been cleaned out, you look right next to where our garage
is. That's what I'm saying.
It is right next to your garage.
The first thing, I see there.
That's a town road,
but it comes. It also comes down east on 44.
It flows right down. Yeah. When you get a heavy rainstorm, that whole area goes to a river temporarily.
It's a river, and the river runs.
And then eventually it's going to pour down into the lake because that's where
the lake is. It goes under the road.
Is there room there for a sort of step biofiltration weapon, and who owns that land?
That's what I think could be done. I think there is something that could be done.
Private.
It's private property, but it's.
Because that, to me, when you have something like that, because you also have the contribution that's coming from Belvo, which means someone could argue, well, that's coming down Belvo, that's town water.
That's when the state right that. The state in that particular, because this has been an issue, so the state says it's a town problem, the town says it's a state problem.
But the solution might be really a very, very good step by filtration, where you've got the first one captures the flush, most of the sediment, and then you move it through a series of purification basins to the lake, and that may be the best solution, and with regular maintenance planning.
So maybe it doesn't require a study to study this particular place?
Probably not. It's obviously not working. I would like, can we get the money to fix it?
Well, Mary's going to get the money.
Well, Mary is.
No, but I mean.
Donald.
Yeah, no, we do have time.
Well, I think you could do the study, but I think the study will prove the obvious.
It will.
And if you think that the study will help to leverage solutions, I'm not, I mean, there's clearly a problem, and there's clearly a very good environmental solution to that. And you're very familiar with the whole concept of rain gardens and infiltration. This all could be handled, and I think the DOT will never do it, because they are arguing about whose water it is. But if you could get some on the land and create this, I mean, one could for $30,000 create a pretty efficient stormwater management system. And I guess the study might be able to show is what are the most severe point sources into the lake. You know, there's a lot of non point, but maybe what I'd like to see is this, and then you can say this is the number one, and it's contributing X amount of pollutants in the lake. That would be useful. Useful for
well, actually, that's why we tried the lake. Don Madden has been taking samples from the points of entry.
But it'd be nice to tie those back to percent contributions. If you could point
to
a sediment low to amount of dissolved pollutants, and that, and actually have that you could say with some authority that actually this particular point is accounting for X percent of the degradation of lake for lake. I think that's very powerful. I mean, that may not be the case. I mean, I'd love to talk to you offline about this sometime. There's many ways to, but I'm not going to, I don't personally favor many of the POC, it's my opinion, but there are four other commissioners here who.
That's fine.
Well, you can ask them if they could overrule me too.
Well, it's actually fine. I'm really interested in the end result.
Tell me again what you're going to do with this grant money here again.
Well,
it wasn't listening right over my head.
If the grant would be to study this, well, the particular Bellville road problem, but there are two other places too that are a problem. One is over by Hotchkiss. They've got quite a sand delta going out of there. So there's clearly.
It's not a brook.
Part of it? I think
the other side. I'm not quite sure where the sediment's all coming from. It may be more than one place. And apparently they did do something with Sucker Brook about 20 years ago because of it. But I'm not sure. But if we had grant money for someone to actually look at three or four different places, even the two biggest ones would be,
How do you know the biggest ones? So that's what I'm asking you. I think would be really valuable would be to go around the lake and identify the three or four hot spots and quantify what percentage of degradation they're causing. I mean, you may be able to, by cleaning up one or two hot spots, clean up 50% of the deal with 50%. I mean, I don't know, but that's the kind of stuff that makes funders look at.
That would be my goal, yes. Because if we could take care of those, which I think are contributing quite a lot, I think that with what the Lake Association is doing with education and homeowners, and even what P&Z is doing by asking people come with an application and you talk about buffers with them and you talk about stormwater runoff and protecting the lake. I think there's a lot of movement in that direction where I'm not quite sure where it's coming from. It might be coming from the architects and the landscape designers that want their application approved so they know that this is what.
I think there's also higher sensitivity. People are beginning to connect the dots in a way they didn't, and I think a lot of the work you've done, the Lake Association, there's a greater consciousness of how water, it's not perfect, but I think it's certainly getting much better. People know that. It's definitely an awareness. What are the motivation of landowners? I don't know. Whether it's to get an approval or whether it's to do the right thing, I like to think maybe it's a bit of both.
A little bit of both.
Yeah,
no. It's
but
probably a bit of both.
I think a little bit of both.
I do, yeah.
Well, I think the landscape group designers and architects take pride in their work, and they want to present the landowner with something that,
that's right.
But then it moves on from there.
And it's good that people that want these things. But I think it's a process, but it's not, in my opinion, I'd like to see it move faster. I think you could identify hotspots, and you've got something you can go after for specific remediation strategies, and you can tackle this problem, which I think we're all, there isn't a person on this commission who's not concerned.
Because there is a remediation technology for this.
It's growing all the time.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
It's.
Can we just go back to the POCD?
Yes.
I don't want you guys to fall asleep driving home in a minute. That, you know, you're more confident that you have the total support from the commission about this, and even the document, maybe if you can come back to us with feedback that it does really adequately already reflect the
total support on this document?
Total support on applying for grants for lake restoration or lake projects or whatever it is, and that we thought we had conveyed that the importance of lakes and all wetlands and other environmental issues in that document. Okay. And that if you needed something more, that would be able to happen without necessarily reprinting that. Yeah?
Well, we've had people come before us with a question on the fire ask. Does this reflect the POCD? And I guess, you know, we kind of say the same thing about this. That your grant request reflects the desires in the POCD.
That would be right on.
Yeah.
Spot on. That actually is consistent, and we, as much as we can, support that, because it's all in the implementation. I don't really place a lot of stock whether it's priority one or priority two, because we had to sort of set the priorities in some sort of way. I think the important thing is that certainly we recognize that some of the priorities will become priority one, either through happenstance or circumstances or whatever. We certainly, I think, what you're doing is very consistent with the POCD, and we certainly, you know, if and when you write a grant and show us the grant, we certainly can give you a letter from, I believe we can, I certainly don't think why not, a letter from the planning, so I'm saying it's consistent with the POCD, and if we have to clarify, if you find the people there at this meeting think that our generalized language is not covering lakes enough, we can certainly deal with that at that time and say that it was the intent of this commission, we talked about wetlands writ large, and in fact wetlands include lakes, and we certainly was our intent. And we certainly can make that very clear.
And it's the town's intent.
The town's intent, yes.
Yeah.
So,
it's the town's intent.
So I can put in the minutes that it's the consensus of the commission that this is in line with the...
Consistent
with the POCD.
Consistent with the POCD.
I don't see how we can read that thing
I don't know.
How much we treasure our lakes. I can't imagine anyone reads
right.
That. I don't want to get that.
Right.
And I think that, you know, we would hate, Salisbury would have a high priority in Connecticut because, you know, even like Chuck Lee said yesterday, because I told him about my idea and the stormwater runoff thing, and he said that, you know, Salisbury is such a unique town. It is so special. It has six lakes.
Right.
It has an enormous amount of other natural resources, unique natural resources, that actually the whole town would be considered a high priority, you know, to protect the natural resources.
It's called among the conservation biologists, it's called the Nantucket of Connecticut. And the only reason they say that is because Nantucket has the greatest concentration of rare habitats and rare species in all of Massachusetts. And it was one of the first, you know, so it really is one of the most. It's a gem. That's why I moved here.
They're not Nantucket. Not Nantucket.
No. No, but I just think that's very interesting when people say that. For a long time, that was the gold standard of rare species and rare habitats and important equipment and unique ecosystems, the grass plains and the dunes and that, because considered that crown jewel of Massachusetts.
So I guess it's just kind of, you know, figuring out how to, what...
But do what Kathy says. Do see really, I mean, you're reading it in a very literal and very, you're looking, yeah, we're looking great to have lakes in there. But do look and see if they consider this language so vague that it's an impediment. I can't believe that reading this and reading our commitment to restoration and stewardship and that, it's all over, that they won't see us as firmly supporting the lakes.
Right. I mean, how to, you know, how to go about, I guess Donald knows how to go about with the politics. I'm not a political person, so I don't know.
I think it's fantastic, right?
And I guess we'll take this letter, by the way, and so this, can we start to develop a file for the next revision of the POCD? POCD 2021, thank you, Mary. Thank you for your concern.
And actually, Mary's letter doesn't have a date on it. So it's a good idea to start a file and put a date on this.
I think it was in very informal. Mary put it together and I said, please, wasn't there an email? It must have come. But I think we need to have a file in the office that says POCD revisions, and as things come up for the next, so we can right away when we get to the next one, whoever's going to be here, it's not going to be me, for the next POCD.
Garrett.
Wherever we'll have some sort of organized file. These are things that we need to. Thank you, Mary.
Thanks, Michael.
All right. Now getting on to another piece of water, the Housatonic Wild and Scenic meeting. That's tomorrow evening. And did you all get the invitation by Lois Pinney from COP?
I did that.
So you didn't get it, I meant, no. It went, interestingly enough, to the planning and zoning members of, didn't come to Sharon and didn't go to Cornwall. And I sort of wrote back, why not Sharon or Cornwall? And didn't get a response. But they have been inviting particularly planning and zoning commission members for a meeting tomorrow night in Cornwall where they're discussing the whole wild and scenic thing. And it's not without some local concern and controversy. I don't know how many of you read Gene Green's letter in the Lakeville Journal. Gene Green has been one person who's been very concerned about losing control, about overuse of the river. There's a lot of controversy going on about bike paths and private property and concern about actually increasing tourism on the river. So it's not a neutral thing. Initially I was actually going to be out of town, but I'm actually going to be in town tomorrow night. So I think I'm going to go, but I would hope some other members of the commission would go because I think it's an important issue. As I understand it, it might be that they want this now because not all towns have been as good about going and referring to the river commission. I think the river commission has had difficulty in some towns getting kind of we refer in that. So that's, I think, might be behind some of this, but I certainly don't want to be the only one going.
What time is it?
I think it's 7 or 7:30.
Where is it?
In Cornwall, somewhere down there.
Somewhere
in Cornwall.
Did you get the invitation?
Did you get it?
Yeah.
Oh, you did.
First, was it email?
Yes, it was email.
I'm sure.
You got it. Mike, did you get it?
No, I got it. Oh, yeah. I've been away from my email for a while.
But so. I am not able to go. I really wish I could. I hope that's taped.
It might be in my inbox.
Okay. Hold on.
Are you going to go, Martin?
Yeah.
Good.
Well,
I can figure out where it was.
Well, wait a second.
Is it at the school?
Stop it.
I want to say it's at the home office or in school, but I'm not possible.
No, wait a second. I'm going to dig it out of here somewhere. Oh, God. And I meant to send it to you, and I didn't. I don't know why they didn't send it. Okay, hold on. Back into the history of it all. People wouldn't send me so many emails that were just finding it. Something with Lois Pinney. Do you have any? Some time ago. Do you have that email, Mike?
No, it's on my system at home.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Okay, I can't lay my hands on it.
Just put a Housatonic Wild and Scenic and see what happens.
No, I'm looking actually for the invitation. I just don't understand why it's not showing up.
You didn't get it, Fred.
Well, like I said, I've been traveling, and...
I can't find it now.
Might be in my inbox.
A woman named Lois Penny, who I guess works at the...
She works at...
I don't know, I can't. I'm sorry. I just can't do it. I mean, you got it, hold on, Kathy? Kathy's got it, she's more organized than me. What day is it? Did you say that?
3/27?
Yes, 3/27.
Wow. I have never understood.
Cornwall Town Hall, 24 Pine Street, Wednesday 17th at 7 p.m. Included with this invitation is a fact sheet on the Wild and Senate River program.
7 p.m.
Oh, this is what I rang you about, Nancy, what I was looking for.
And I said, I didn't have it today.
And I couldn't remember how I got it. Then they sent it out, but that's why I couldn't pick it up. Okay.
I don't need to know where it went, or she didn't have it anymore.
You want me to resend it?
Yeah, could you send it back to me online?
Anybody else need it?
I think I got it, Kathy. I won't swear.
I don't know.
Where's the meeting at school?
Cornwall Town Hall.
The Town Hall.
7 p.m. Pine Street. 24 Pine Street.
That's in Cornwall.
Where Pine Street is.
Do you know where that is?
I know where Pine Street is.
In Cornwall? Well, sure, it's 7 p.m. Cornwall Town Hall. Fred, you want to come?
I will try. I do want to come. I would like to.
Do you want me to send this to you again? I can send it to you again.
Please. Yeah, I think I've probably got it.
Well, as long as we have some people come, but I am going to be here, so I am going to go.
Okay.
Because I'm interested in, I think we should.
I'll probably make it. I'll try.
Right. Anyway.
Okay. Cornwall is down on the top of the library.
Okay.
So it's the Town Hall on Pine Street. That's in what, is it?
That's what, yeah.
It's in regular Cornwall, right?
Yeah, it's in Cornwall.
Is that what you call it, regular Cornwall?
It's in regular Cornwall.
Cornwall.
Not the big bridge.
What's up with 125 or something, right?
No, I think you go down to Cornwall Bridge, you take a left on Forks, where it's Scranton.
Yes,
and you go about like 4 or 5 miles or something.
Yeah, you turn right on Pine Street. Turn right on the Pine Street.
Turn right, yeah, okay.
In the library, okay. The church, and the town hall, all down the same street.
I'd like to hear what they have to say. All right, because Gene Green thinks we should all be very concerned about it. Now, it's time for Kathy.
Thank you, Michael. When Jocelyn came to a meeting at the end of last year, I don't think you were here that night, she agreed that I would prompt her to send us an update if there was something to report, she'd write a call it out at meetings. So this is the first one we've had from Jocelyn. Four issues to do with the Northwest Planning Council. Firstly, that they're still on the running for this $200,000 Regional Performance Incentive Grant, and they would know about that by the end of the calendar year. But one of the things that it would provide for, that's $200,000 across all the member towns. One of the things it will provide for is what's called here a circuit rider, a professional that's experienced in small town economic development. And she would say that the firehouse would be a perfect example for somebody like this, if indeed it's normally sold and changing by then. Second thing is just an update that the STEEP grant awards, they should hear about this June or July. And this would be the Main Street Investment Fund, and they've sort of earmarked that for Salisbury Academy Street, the pedestrian walkway. But they should hear about that June, July. Then also the small cities funding for the regional housing rehabilitation loan, which again is 8 member towns. They've already got 9 applications from this town for the funding should it come our way. Still waiting to hear for that. And then on the 24th of April, they're holding a ribbon-cutting ceremony in Sharon around their new visitor information map and directory at the Sharon Shopping Centre, which I haven't seen. Has anyone else seen? We hope to find appropriate locations for a visitor information map in Salisbury and Lakeville, and we'll be working with local business owners over the next few months to do that. So there is something now in Sharon.
This is the wayfinding stuff,
right? Wayfinding, right.
and that's going to have a ribbon cutting on April 24th.
It's a kiosk, Kathy?
I don't know. I mean, it was a kiosk. I think I might have seen it going in after that.
I think I've referred to it as a kiosk.
A kiosk, okay. She's called it a new visitor information map and directory.
Okay.
A reminder that there's a US Department of Agriculture workshop in the Salisbury Town Hall on the 18th of this month. Learn what the USDA can do for you for loans, grants, and technical assistance. Gee, I better send that to Mary, right?
Well, I was just thinking about Mary, and I was also going to ask you on this, is that we bore all the stuff with the housing and the wayfinding. I mean, is there any way we can interest the collaborative to be a bit interested in green infrastructure, not always the built infrastructure, but could we get them interested in some of the natural resource issues that the board would need help there too? I mean, you know, they seem to have a very narrow focus on a few things.
That's a good point.
Could you ask at the next meeting whether they would be willing to take some of this? And definitely, I think that's a great idea, the USDA, because that,
So that is here, actually, in our town hall, 3 to 5 on Thursday. And again, unfortunately, I can't go. Otherwise, I would have actually liked to have gone to that too.
The main marriage. Could you, you pass that on to Mary,
yeah,
please?
Yeah. I think she should. I think she might be interested in what goes on tomorrow too. I'll talk to her about that.
Oh yeah,
yeah. Ellen would be interested in that.
Yeah.
I mean, these are important initiatives on the green infrastructure that I think.
Mary has put together some remarkable materials for Lake Association. We're just holding off right now on publishing them in terms of how to do it, when to do it, who to do it, you know, so that you don't sort of have a data dump all of a sudden. But so she's interested in what some of the other things are happening. Finally, Jocelyn's got a comment here about the Salisbury Affordable Housing Commission that they are reviewing the current draft zoning regulations with an eye on how it will affect housing opportunities, and she will forward a list of recommendations, comments from the Salisbury Affordable Housing Commission no later than 2 weeks before the public hearing. That's a heads
Which
up.
Which is now, right?
Which is now?
Yeah.
Almost now.
Oh, good. So now we're going to have a list, right?
Well, and these are things that weren't conveyed to us before?
There were some things conveyed by Phil Moore.
I'll just read what she said.
I also think that this goes to both to Mary and to others. I mean, just because you say something at a public hearing, you listen very nicely to everybody and listen very seriously, that the commission sometimes has to make a decision about what to include and what not to include.
Yeah.
And I think some of the stuff in the lake stuff, we made a decision not to go, there was a sense that we not to put them in, but other, we felt we were covering that. So likewise, I think the Affordable Housing Committee may wish a lot of changes, but
we did make changes.
Yeah, we have to evaluate this. Merely right. Stating something at a public hearing does not necessarily, that's our decision as a commission.
And we really did look at what came forward then.
Yeah.
I can't imagine that anything else is coming.
Well, I'm interested in.
Although I know she's looking at them ready. Well, I guess that's a joke.
Right.
We'll have something ready for the public hearing.
No, we got
so
some
that's
help.
The appropriate time.
We did get some helpful input from the Affordable Housing Commission, and we did make some changes.
Well, one of the difficult things about this commission is we're achieved with having a balance between competing needs, and there are a lot of, you know, wait till you get my amendment, one for the POCD for a comprehensive vernal pool. 750 feet, no development around any vernal. I mean, and we have a job, and I think we take it seriously. Maintaining a balance between very strong competing interests is not easy, because you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that everyone needs to understand that we listen to the public hearings, we take the things in very seriously, public comment. But sometimes we, in our own wisdom, as elected commissioners, make decisions of what to include and what not to include. It isn't just because you bring it, it's going to be included.
Well, if there are some new things, then it might go into a process later on that's
right.
Together with cluster housing or something, one of the future projects that we're going to be working
That's correct.
In the upcoming months.
I agree, because I think one thing I desperately want to see us is to move this process to a conclusion for all of us.
But I think we are all looking forward to hearing any other suggestions.
Of course, and I'm just prefacing when someone talks about, you know, I've got a little bit of, it sort of fear that all of a sudden we're going to get a large laundry list of things they would like, and I think I missed, we stated to the commission is that we listen, we can take information, we can make a decision whether we'll amend at that point or do what Fred said, but that's why we have five people here to weigh this sort of stuff.
We have a really good product that we're going to take to the public hearing, and there may be other things in the future.
I think your idea maybe if there are really wholesale changes of putting them into the to-do, I mean, cluster we have to do too. And I know Tom will not do the cluster for us. We'll have to find someone else to do the cluster. And I have some ideas.
Good.
It's now 8 o'clock, and I'm going to go home for the first time in about, and you have to go home. I'd like to motion to adjourn unless someone else has an office that will keep us
moved.
Is there a second?
Yes, I see.
Yes, that's Kathy Shire, all those in favor.